come now to one of the greatest passages in the whole Bible, passage I love talking about. Isaiah saw the Lord. It's such a good passage that I think we should listen to it in the original Hebrew.
Bishnat mot hamelech Uzziyahu, vayeret Adonai yoshev al kisse ram venisa veshulav meleim et haichal. Serafim omdim mimma'al lo, shesh kenafayim le'echad, בשתיים יחסה פניו, ובשתיים יחסה רגליו, ובשתיים יעופף. וקרא זה אל זה ואמר, קדוש, 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 אדוני צבאות מלוא כל הארץ כבודו.
Isaiah saw the Lord. This is a privilege given to very few. Paul was allowed to see into heaven, but he never described it, and he was very loath to talk about it. John saw great visions of heaven, and he did describe it and wrote the book of Revelation, but he resorts to apocalyptic writing, mysterious and symbolic, almost as if he can't find human terms to describe it. Isaiah does attempt to describe it, but also goes to symbols and doesn't really describe God so much as the things around him, the fire, the angels, and so on. I'm not sure that Isaiah fully saw God, actually, because we read the house was filled with smoke. Almost as if in seeing God there's as much hiding as there is revealing. Same with Moses. He wanted to see the Lord, but the Lord hid him in a cleft of a rock and covered him with his hand. So Moses only saw the back of the Lord. Same with Abraham. His experience of God in Genesis 15 was a great experience of darkness. A great dread of darkness came on him, and then there was fire as well. When Hollywood tries to portray the presence of God, the screen always gets brighter and brighter till it hurts your eyes, but I think the Bible is almost the opposite. When God reveals himself, it almost seems to get darker. And the overwhelming sense in all these cases is a great sense of reverence and awe. They certainly don't want to go shouting about it from the rooftops. Look at the angel in Isaiah 6, with wings covering his face and wings covering his feet, almost as if to say, "Be careful where you walk." Covering the feet, reminiscent of Moses told, "Take off your shoes, the place you're standing is holy ground." Covering their faces, lest the sight, as Macbeth would have said, should sear their eyeballs. Covering their mouths, lest they talk too much. Because Ecclesiastes says, "God is in heaven, you are on earth, so let your words be few." There are stained glass windows with the words "holy, holy, holy" in them. I came across one at Belvedere Church in Knysna where the script looked like "noisy, noisy, noisy." I think nothing could be further from the truth. When we come really close to the presence of God, I think silence is more likely to take place. I've known of two people who had death experiences where their heart stopped beating on the operating table and they saw themselves leave their body and go to another place that they could hardly describe. But the interesting thing when they came back is both of them were filled with a sense of sadness. They were glad to be back, but they were very sad to have left that place. But also both of them, and these were very sane, down-to-earth, solid Christians, were very loath to talk about it. I felt very privileged to hear it. And so when people say they've seen a vision of the Lord and rush to write books and do television appearances, I just have my doubts. And then there's an overwhelming sense of the holiness of God. Did you notice when the Jewish rabbi read, "Holy is the Lord Almighty," Kadosh Adonai, he broke into song, almost as if to speak it would have been too irreverent. And then there's a sense hidden in this passage of the infinity of God. Albert Einstein possibly came closer to describing infinity of any human being when he melded together the ideas of space and time. We had always thought of those as being separate entities, and he talked about a space-time continuum. And when you add the speed of light into that, and God is light, amazing things happen. Well, I found out something when I was studying for this talk that I'd never known before. For starters, I thought the phrase holy, holy, holy came up often in scripture, but that was simply because we sing it so often in hymns and songs. It actually only occurs twice, once in Isaiah 6 and once in Revelation chapter 4. They're almost identical except for the second line. They both begin, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. But Isaiah goes on to say, the whole earth is filled with his glory. Change that to the whole universe because it's true. John's angels go on to say, who was and who is to come. Space and time, and the Lord fills them both. The Bible knew about the space-time continuum 2,000 years before Einstein did. And so, as Isaiah comes into this awesome presence of infinity and absolute holiness, what is his instant reaction? It's awareness of his own sinfulness. And that's inevitable. If you come close to the presence of God, by comparison, you will become very aware of your own sinfulness. And what is really striking is he's not just aware of his own sinfulness, he's aware of the sinfulness of those around him, almost as if he's complicit in their sin. What a difference it might make when we see on TV evil being done, instead of saying how bad those people are, saying, Lord, forgive us our trespasses. I'm a part of this world and its sinfulness. I wonder what a difference that might make in heavenly places. But the great thing about Isaiah 6 is his sin is dealt with. The coals touch his lips and the angel says, your sin is atoned for. You get the feeling that's once and for all. It'll never come up again, Isaiah. It is finished. And the burning coal and the pain on the lips give you an idea of the cost of atonement. And we know that the full cost of the atonement was the cross of Jesus Christ. And so out of all this, this amazing vision of God and this awareness of his own sinfulness, Isaiah gets his call. And I have no doubt that the best call comes from just there. Awareness of the holiness of God, awareness of my own sinfulness. Then no matter how successful my calling may become, I will remain humble. I'm glad I didn't get Isaiah's call. I've been very privileged. I worked among people, young people, for the first 13 years who basically were receptive to what I had to say. Many, many people who really longed to be closer to God. Isaiah's calling is to stop people from understanding, to stop them from hearing, to stop them from seeing, because God has already decided that he's going to discipline Judah. Once and for all, he's going to root idolatry out through the Babylonian captivity to take place in 150 years' time. And you know what? It was successful. They've never worshipped idols again. And so in Isaiah, we find these many negative passages because that was part of his calling. But verse 13, we've learnt, is now very typical of Isaiah. In the midst, or often at the end of a long negative passage, a great passage of restoration. And for the second time, he uses one of his favorite images of a great tree that has been chopped down, and out of the stump arises the seed of the Holy One, our Lord Jesus Christ. And so this great vision of God that in many causes a sense of darkness, a sense of fear, of awe, and yet it's something greatly to be wished for. When Zechariah confronted the angel and said, who are you? Gabriel said, I am Gabriel, I stand in the presence of the Lord. As if being in the presence of the Lord is all you could ask for. That's what I'd do for a living. It is something, Hamlet would have said, devoutly to be wished. Now, when Jesus left the world, his last words were, I will be with you always. We have the promise of the constant presence of Christ. Often, of course, we don't feel his closeness. And I don't have any tricks to say how you can do it, but all I know is that when I take time to be alone, to be quiet, to make myself aware of the presence of the Lord with my Bible, and usually with a decent period of silence, the presence of the Lord does come closer. When I'm very busy, or worried, or letting my holiness slip a little, the presence of the Lord seems to slip away. Of course, he doesn't slip away, but the feeling does. And so the presence of the Lord, greatly to be desired, greatly needed, Perhaps the world needs nothing more today than a real vision of Almighty God high and lifted up, and to hear the angels say, "Ah, but I'm a little reticent to say those words."
Kadosh, Kadosh, Kadosh.